I'm Deborah Sandidge. Thank you very much for coming to B&H Photo Video. I'm excited to be here over the next hour and talk to you with you about long exposure creativity. I do workshops and presentations throughout the year and also do a lot of different photo events. So that's really what I like to do is work with people one-on-one. So I have a lot of workshops coming up. You can find me at DeborahSandidge.com, of course. But over the next hour, I'll be talking about long exposures at the edge of night, long exposures with variable neutral density filters, and then we'll talk about the big guns, the 10-stop neutral density filters, which really change things quite a bit. So long exposure creativity, we have what naturally occurs at low light, also at night and daytime. We're going to be talking about color enhancing filters, polarizers, variable neutral density filters, the 10-stop neutral density filters, and also the additional stacked filters. So it's a lot of different things, a lot of different tools that you can use and apply to your photography for some very creative work. Low light naturally happens at the blue hour, and that's really one of my favorite times to shoot. So I'll be talking a lot about the blue hour during the next hour. So this is just simply using the elements of low light and also getting these beautiful reflections that happen at low light. And with this particular, I was using a 28 to 300 millimeter lens just in capturing the essence of the blue hour as this Eiffel Tower. One of my favorite ideas of working with long exposure is to build in the idea of multiple exposure with long exposure. So I mean, this is a little bit different. You saw some of the long exposure images in that first one that you saw, the Valenceau plane. But the idea of this, I'm working with long exposure and multiple exposure to create a little bit different image. Some people call it a time stack because basically what it is time lapse. And I'll be explaining a little bit more about that, but it's another idea to work with. Evolving clouds. This is another personal project. As storms develop, you get these wonderful clouds, but rather than freeze the action of the clouds, I like to show them evolving over time. So the idea of this is doing several different exposures to get the idea of this sense of motion with the clouds. Low light. I was just in Vegas. I literally just got back from Vegas, so I'm a little bit jet lagged. So coming back and coming here to New York, but this is New York in Vegas, which is a lot of fun. So if you want to hit two cities at once, you can do this in Vegas, only in Vegas. But again, using low light, I can capture these streaks of light from passing cars with an exposure of about 8 seconds, and I'll talk more about how to do that. But we're going to move right into photographing at twilight, all the beautiful things that can happen, really, just at this time of day. This is my favorite time of day to shoot. So I made this shot in infrared. I'm an infrared photographer. I have a book called Digital Infrared Photography. And I started by shooting in the afternoon with infrared. Then I wanted to work into the idea of sunset, of course, because it's a fabulous sunset location. But what I was waiting for was this. This is the blue hour. To me, this is when things start to get very exciting and far more interesting. So when the people were all crowded around, they're taking the picture, the sun went down, everybody clapped, and then they left. Like, you could just all just cruise lines, just all these people left. And I'm thinking, no, wait, this is, you've got 20 minutes and things are gonna start evolving. They're gonna start getting very interesting. The light is going to change in the sky. We're gonna get this beautiful blue color, and all the little city lights are gonna be able to come on in the city, and that's when I like to work. That's, to me, the most interesting part of the day. So if you come on a workshop with me, you know that I'm gonna start by building all the shots that we're gonna take at twilight, and then we'll do the other stuff during the day and the long exposure stuff, but I want to make sure we're at a fabulous location. And you can do this travel photography, or you can do it in your own neighborhood. Just look for that beautiful, beautiful blue hour. Know where this is? Yes. And if you, it's not that this particular rail is purple, but I made a purple through light painting. It's just another kind of cool creative thing you can do. So I have an Phoenix LD22 flashlight, and I use little robe gel, so you can just cover your flashlight and over 30 seconds just sort of paint that in. If you're a flash photographer, you can do this with a single flash, but I just found it really easy just to go ahead and light paint it. So it's just an idea, but during twilight, of course, that's the most expressive, most beautiful time. Couldn't do this as easily during the day, nor would it make as an expressive image. So I'm working with the idea of low light during twilight. So what is twilight? We've got the beautiful quality of light, vivid blue pastel light, about 20, 30 minutes after sunset or before sunset. It's very balanced. So you know when the sun comes up, it gets very, very contrasting. It's difficult to take a shot that is very balanced. But during twilight, the light is balanced, so everything is going to be pretty much evenly lit in the scene. So landscape, cityscape look fabulous during twilight. And you want to look for creative opportunities, such as streaks of light from passing cars, soft blur with clouds and waters. So there's all kinds of really creative applications during the blue hour. Someone was asking me about San Antonio. This is the Riverwalk area of San Antonio, which is one of my favorite places. In fact, I'll be off that location next week doing a workshop, so we've got a great group coming with us. One of the things that I like to build in my photography, what I like my students to learn, is to get an idea of how you can put something different into a photograph rather than coming away with something that's just more documenting the experience. You want something that's going to have something personal, something that else that you had put into this photo. And for me, I just love the Riverwalk area. It's absolutely amazing. And then you have all these water taxis that were going by, which really made it interesting. So what I'm doing is I'm using the low light of twilight and letting my camera do all the work for me. I'm setting up exposures that are about 4 seconds. And actually here, these are just the water ferries. That completely transforms the scene. If I had the water ferry frozen, it gives you a different sense. But if you can see the water ferries moving across, it gives you this really elegant sense of motion. And this is easily achievable by everybody here. You don't have to have any special equipment. What I'm doing to achieve this, I'm stopping down, narrowing the aperture so the exposures are a little bit longer. The native ISO of my camera is 64. That makes it a lot easier for that. But those with the ISO, the lowest ISO that you can use. So you're going for 4 or 5 second exposure, and with those three images that I layered into Photoshop. But to me, that makes a lot more expressive image. So with some of the slides, I'll go ahead and I'll give you the recipe for it. So if you just want to get an idea, you saw the shot, and the recipe, how to make the actual shot, will be right here. F16, 4 seconds, 24 to 70 millimeter lens. That's a nice walk-around lens. Actually, they make a 24 to 120, which is fabulous. That works really well. But here I'm giving you a more personal, more emotional connection to this particular area rather than just documenting the single photograph. So twilight, the blue hour, here I was with a Nikon project. I was using some of their Coolpix cameras, and then I grabbed a picture with my own camera of this particular area, the Crescent City Bridge. Now the bridges aren't really pink, and the water's not really purple, but what happens is that you can use a simple tool. Color enhancing filter. I use FLW tool, the FLW Hoya filter. Actually, I'm sure that B&H has that particular filter. That has the benefit of extending slightly the exposure time. So again, it's going to help me smooth out that water, and it's going to enhance the violet and the gold tones in the image, which is what I like to do. Yes, you could do this in Camera Raw if you want to play around with the idea, but extending exposure, all that has to happen in capture. So that's the difference. That's why I might use something like that. If you want to set the white balance, I usually have mine around 4,000 degrees Kelvin to work with that. Sunny works nicely with that Hoya FLW filter. So the recipe for this Crescent City Bridge picture, you can see it was just F16. Why F16? I'm stopping down to create these beautiful little starbursts. You see the starbursts that run across the length of the bridge. That's an element of stopping down and having these little starbursts happen. And each lens is going to interpret that a little bit differently. So 15 seconds, ISO 200, 24 to 70 millimeter lens. Again, I find that lens to be very valuable and working with that. But you'll hear me during this presentation talking about stopping down and doing certain things with a camera to be able to create a more expressive, a more dramatic, a little bit more glamorous. The bridge is very architectural, and it's just a function of getting transportation from A to B. But here you can make it more of a work of art by shooting at twilight and getting all the different creative effects, such as the starburst. This is a marina in my area. Called Marina Island. It's in Sanford, Florida. It's one of my favorite places to shoot. I like to go back and revisit locations just because it's always different under different weather conditions and light conditions. And it's also good practice. You shoot it, then you set a personal goal to do something a little bit different. I shot this during the day, liked the idea. I did a time lapse, and I'll show you that later too, the idea of a time lapse. But with this, the tools that I'm using, when I look at a composition, I look at what works, what doesn't work, what can be improved. So as photographers, we become problem solvers to be able to create. Oh, yes. Oh, we can.
Yeah, just make a point upwards. So down here, actually, lower?
No.
Yep.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Can you hear me in the back better?
Yeah.
Oh, fantastic. Thank you. Thank you. Sorry for that. So the tools I'm looking for in this scene to be able to correct some of the issues that I see, I'm working with balancing the composition. I have extreme light conditions at the top. Yes, you could do an HDR, but I've got the boats. That's going to be way, way too complicated. So the idea of working with this, I'm looking at what I can do during capture to create a more expressive image. Well, the first thing I needed to do was use a reverse graduated neutral density filter. And the function of that is that it's going to hold light back at the brightest part of the scene. So you can see right at the bottom is the brightest part. And this neutral density filter fades towards the top. So it makes it a lot easier to create a balanced exposure. The second thing I used was that FLW filter for fun, because I love the idea of that. And what I did is I just held the graduated neutral density filter over that horizon line to be able to create that more expressive image. So the recipe for this particular picture is F8. 25 seconds was really kind of long. You don't want to work that long because the boats are moving, but I knew in this case that I had made several test exposures and I like this one best. Stopping down for the little starbursts with the lights. Use a white balance of around 4,500, I think is what I have for that. But this enhanced the blue tones. Again, the little starbursts made the entire scene much more glamorous, much more interesting. And the function of that variable, that graduating neutral density filter, allows me to balance the light in the scene. It'd be very difficult to try to take two exposures and blend them together with the masks. You know, things that move, that's the difference. And that's the problem. You can do a lot of exposure blending, but if there's things that are moving in the scene, it becomes a bit more challenging. So you are the artist with a camera. And when you come upon a certain scene, it's really up to you to be able to decide how you want to communicate this picture with a certain mood, a certain depth of feeling, a certain emotion. And I love this area. This is Paris. This is the Alexander Bridge. And I love the idea of working with that. But photographers know that a blank sky is the nemesis of a photographer. To have a blank sky is a little bit difficult. So I'm composing so that there's not a lot of sky in the picture. Kind of documenting the idea of this, but then trying to do it in a glamorous way. So in this case, again, I did use that FLW filter. You can set your white balance or do it in post, so you have a little of the blue and magenta, so it's very easy to do. 20 seconds, F16. Now the reason that I'm moving into this 20 seconds and into the 30 second range is because I want to be able to smooth out the water. I don't want the tension of the water to be too rippled. I want the feeling of the picture to give the viewer a sense of something relaxed, something beautiful. So it's, again, I'm working more with the feeling and the mood of the picture. So the FLW filter enhances the violet tones and the gold tones. And then in post, I won't talk a lot about post, but in this particular image, I did want to bring up the fact that you can, in Lightroom or Camera Raw, use the graduated filter, and you can add a little bit of color to the graduated filter, so it didn't hurt. So now I have some variation in the sky. So it's very, very easy to do. So here you can see the settings that I use, and you can tone down the sky a little bit and add a little bit of color. So that's just an easy little Photoshop trick or Lightroom trick that you can use. So twilight tips. You can convey motion, create a sense of time passing, compared to freezing the action. And I do like to do both approaches. When we were in Vegas, we were looking at all these wonderful fountains. And the first thing is like, okay, let's freeze the action of the fountain. That's one idea. Because you want to maximize the opportunities with a great subject. So the next step was pull in a variable neutral density filter and slow down the action and have a mood very soft, relaxed mood about a picture. So that's something that we'll be talking about. You need a good tripod. Oh my goodness. That's the hardest thing that I see with students when I'm out teaching, is that they're fighting against the tripod. Maybe it's slipping, or maybe the head, or they have a pistol grip, and you get the composition, then it starts to sag, and that's the most trying thing. So if you have a tripod that will work with you, it allows you to do everything that you need to do. You can use mirror lockup. I killed two remotes, these little guys right here in Iceland, two of them. So I had to use the exposure delay mode. That works well too. So that will raise the mirror and also be able to allow you to take a picture without the use of a remote. I find the remote a lot easier, but that's a really simple thing to use. The tricks or tips, really, narrow aperture for the starburst. We talked about that, and I'll talk about that again, I'm sure. Shoot in RAW for the most flexibility. When you're shooting in JPEG, you don't have all the information available to you. So if you wanted to change the white balance, you're limited here. So shooting RAW allows you the most flexibility in post-processing. And you can use different tools. So the biggest decision is out in the field as you're doing these long exposures at night or at twilight, is do you use or not noise reduction. So noise reduction, if you notice, will take generally about the same time as your regular exposure. So if my exposure is 30 seconds, then I have to wait another 30 seconds for noise reduction. Then things may change in the scene that I'm missing. So I have to decide, do I want to do it now or do I want to post? So that's just really personal, how you experience in what you're shooting at the time. This is Paris. This is sort of an iconic location, but I wanted to do something a little bit different. I've seen the picture on postcards, and I thought, how can I make it Deb? You know, what is there about this composition that I can make it more personal and come away with something that's a little bit different? Compositionally, what I like to suggest is tilt the camera. Instead of having everything so lined up and straight and static, if you tilt the camera slightly before exposure, so now we have this flow, a rhythm that's a little bit more dynamic. So that's a very easy tip as you're out shooting. And when I worked with this, we had this windmill. So rather than freeze the action, I don't want to create a tense photo of that windmill. I wanted to have a beautiful flow. So I'm working with about a 4-second exposure as it rotated. So I had an interesting kind of a honeycomb effect with that particular image. So again, I did use that FLW filter. It brought up a little more of the red tones and accentuated the gold tones. And you can see what happened with a starburst. So I'm stopping down for that. F11, 4 seconds. And you may have to experiment with that. You may find that in your light conditions, 4 seconds isn't enough to really get that full rotation. That maybe you need something more like 6 seconds or 8. But rather than freeze the action, I thought it'd be more expressive to use a little bit long exposure. This is very easy to do. Now you might find, let's say you're at the limits of your camera. Maybe you're at the scene and you've set it up and you've stopped down as much as you can stop down. Your ISO is as low as it can go and it's still too fast. Whatever it is too bright. That's when you incorporate the use of a tool like a variable neutral density filter. Even a polarizer will give you a little bit of extra time. So those are the tools that you can use. And we'll be talking more about that. Now this is where I stopped down for starburst. You can see, rather than have, if I shot this at f4 or 5.6, all the little points of light would look a bit more like little blobs of light. We wouldn't have that little starburst. So I wanted this to become very glamorous. So I'm stopping down for the starburst effect. In this particular image, I did use a couple of exposures to be able to create bit more balanced scene, and sometimes there's a time when you really need to use HDR, and that's very simple. It's just a matter of using the metered exposure, 2 stops under, 2 stops under as a generalization. With this F16, varied shutter speed because it was an HDR, 14 to 24 millimeter lens. That's a fabulous lens. I love working with that particular lens. The problem with the 14 to 24, well, not the problem with the 14 to 24, but the challenge of the 14 to 24 is that it's so large, and if you've seen that, so it's a little bit easier to use a smaller 77 millimeter type of lens, such as the 16 to 35. Lake Eola. So you don't have to go to Paris. You don't have to go all to New York. I mean, in my backyard is this wonderful fountain. So I'm working again with the blue hour, longer exposure. Get the water nice and silky, so there's lots of beautiful reflections and a lot of color in this photograph. And you'll notice what happens. Once you move past twilight, then things get dark, and you lose that beautiful, expressive hour of the blue hour. You can still make some pretty cool pictures, but during the blue hour, you can really knock it out of the ballpark with color. So as far as blue hour creativity, absolutely, there's a million things that you can do. And here's just a few ideas that you can apply to your photography. You can capture the streaks of light from passing cars. It's my favorite thing to do. You saw that in that New York and Vegas picture. You saw the streaks of light. Try using a shutter speed of about 8 seconds or more. And the trick about doing that, and I'll talk about that also, is that you want to time it so as the cars are entering the scene, you've already pressed the shutter, and wait till the cars exit the scene. Because if you stop it before, you'll get just sort of a line halfway through the photograph, and that's not always too fun. So London. Everybody goes to London. Everybody has the same shot. So I wanted to make it more personal, more fun with something that I like to do. So on this bridge, I was waiting for the buses. So as the buses pass, you get this really fantastic sense of motion with color and light as they pass by. So this one was probably, it was 24 to 70 millimeter lens in about 10 seconds in this case. On this bridge, we'll break off to talk about social media for a second. On this particular bridge, I'm from Orlando, Florida. Two guys ran into me and they said, "Are you Deb Sandidge?" I was like, "Yes." They recognized the avatar from Google Plus and Facebook, and they said, "Well, I'm Jim Nix, and you know, I'm Mike Murphy." They were up in this particular area, so you get to meet your friends. Sort of. That's the nice thing about social media, being able to connect with everybody like in this area. So this is the fun stuff. So. I don't know, maybe it's like fishing. I'm just like, you're right there, and here comes a bus, and you're able to capture this really cool shot. So there's something exciting about you doing it. It's a lot of fun. And it certainly makes the picture more dynamic and more interesting. So I'm out there with my cable release, just waiting for that moment as soon as the buses pass by, capturing that. South Beach. I'll be doing a workshop in South Beach later this year. This is what we'll do. This is so much fun. So I'm working with the idea of around 10 seconds, and there's a lot of traffic. So in this case, 10 seconds was a little bit irrelevant. The cars were stopping and moving. But during that time, it kind of looked more interesting. So rather than have, as in the previous image, you have a lot of staccato kind of lights and action. And I like the idea of this. With this particular one, I used Stingray has a color enhancing filter, which is kind of cool, so that it enhances the color in the scene. We'll go back to Tower Bridge, London. Everybody has this particular photograph, but I wanted to have it with the streaks of light from the passing cars. So I'm doing that. And you can still, what I liked about this was being able to capture a few people. Anytime you can have people in the scene, you have a little interesting blur going on there. You know that there's a financial district, so they're all coming and they're going to catch the trains. They're all in their suits. So working with this idea, again, at twilight. Recipe for this image. Tower Bridge, 13 seconds. 16 to 35 millimeter lens. The lens most often that I reach for to be able to capture the entire scene. So the 16 to 35 has worked out really well for me. I'm sure there's a lot of equivalents from other companies, but the idea of this is to capture as much as I can of this scene. Big Ben 2. This is a different version. So you made that horizontal shot. Now it's time to put the camera in portrait orientation and be able to capture a little bit different view. So again, you can see the streaks of light from the passing cars and this fabulous twilight evidence in the blue sky and some really interesting clouds. So this is the idea of working with twilight. F16, 6 seconds. Didn't need the full 8 seconds, but this worked for this particular image. 16 to 35 millimeter lens, very easy to do. So you just have to try it. This is a good thing. You can go into your neighborhood, maybe a city area, just get your camera set up. And it seems really foreign at first, but once you do it a few times, it's absolutely easy and it's a lot of fun. And everything looks, and you never know what you're gonna get. It's always a little bit different. Painted Ladies of San Francisco. Klaus, you were just there in San Francisco, and I think this is another iconic shot that you have to get while you're there. And I wasn't sure I was going to get this shot. I was working with Nikon on a cool pics project at the time, and it had made a couple pictures, but it was going to rain. But just at twilight, we had just a moment where there's a lot of pink that began to reflect in the sky, so I just had a few seconds to be able to make this photograph. So again, I'm waiting for the balanced light. So we have all these beautiful lights in front of the painted ladies, Victorian homes, but yet, you know, these old homes. And then you have the very contemporary cityscape behind the building, and then you have this beautiful sky. So everything kind of relates, but I like the juxtaposition between the old and new. That's a really great place to shoot in San Francisco. This is also the area of the Marine Island. They have some old docks that are left, and this is my favorite place to go and shoot. Every time I go, it's different, and I just love it every time. But I hadn't shot out at twilight. I did a lot of daytime shots, so I thought, I'll just see what happens. So for some reason, my friends packed up, so the little light's gone, they're leaving, so they left. I love what happened. So I had this, the clouds just seemed very, very low, and it were very expressive. So the idea of working with this image again was to use the Hoya FLW filter, just to, again, to smooth out the water. You can see that the water is very silky. So you have the tension between the silky water and the interesting cloud formation. So different times of the day, maximize your opportunities with a great subject. This is the world of Havana. So I was standing on a ledge, probably about this big, and working with a 16 millimeter fisheye lens. So the fun thing about this fisheye lens is not to use it properly. So you have the fisheye lens and you just tilt it down. And when you do, you get this fabulous distortion, which is so much fun. So I have some friends that would cringe, but I love the idea. So here you have this idea of this whole, I mean, you could see all the way across Havana, which is just interesting as far as this cloud. So I love the idea of it. So I captured it with a 24 to 70 millimeter lens, and I zoomed in and got some other details, and I put on the fisheye and got this really interesting look. And this is really one of my favorite shots from that particular area. So I have 16, 30 seconds with the fisheye lens, just tilting that lens down during the exposure. San Francisco, Golden Gate Bridge. Now here's the thing, this is the nice thing about twilight, and if, yeah, a lot of, I had a friend that said, oh, we shouldn't go, it's gonna rain, there's gonna be no twilight. I said, no, twilight doesn't care. It's gonna be twilight. If it rains, it's not gonna matter, it's all gonna be good. And that was the idea. So in building this composition, what I'm thinking about, the idea of incorporating reflections. Anytime that you can incorporate reflections into a photograph, it becomes much more expressive, much more dramatic. It becomes a story in the story. So you can see all these great reflections from the Golden Gate Bridge, and then stopping down for all the starburst effect, again, and using the beautiful light of the blue hour. And then hiking back up to the top. So if you've ever been to this place at Marshall Park, actually, I started at Baker's Beach and walked down to this location, which was not the brightest idea, because when it gets dark, everything looks the same. I had no idea where it came out. So, anyway, bring extra flashlights. But this is the idea. So I was able to capture a lot of interesting things that I like, all my favorite things in one photograph. Golden Gate Bridge, f/11 30 seconds, 28 to 300 millimeter lens. 28 to 300 millimeter lens is a nice travel lens. So if let's say you're with family and they aren't really tolerant of you bringing the whole, all that gear. You can just bring one lens and get a lot of great shots with that. So we'll go back to Havana for just a moment. And obviously this is sunset, not twilight, but that's the idea. So if I have a shot that I want to make it twilight, I want to make sure that I'm there for sunset and have an idea of all the different angles, all the different shots. This is what I wanted to be able to do. So the same as stopping down for starburst, you can do the same thing for the sunburst. Stop down and just position yourself so you just have a tiny edge of the sun that's popping through. So the idea of that is to create more of an expressive image. You see a little bit of texture in the background, and I like to work with the idea of adding texture. It's really easy. I use flypaper demi-jour, I think it's called, but the idea of just building in, because there were no clouds, unfortunately, in this composition. So I was working with adding a little bit of texture, a little bit of interest. But this is what I was waiting for. I like that. But so what happens during twilight, all the city lights come on. You have a lot of gold, a lot of blue, a lot of interest. And so this is the El Moro lighthouse in Cuba. You can go to Cuba on humanitarian, educational, there's all kinds of visas that you can go properly into Cuba. Certainly it's not as, and it's changing quickly. So if you do have a desire, I would suggest to go quickly. So once you've lost the light, you can keep shooting. So there's no rest for weary. You get up before sunrise, get the twilight in the morning, shoot in the morning, and shoot at dark and beyond. So what happens when you lose light can still be kind of interesting. So really interesting. So this is obviously the Eiffel Tower. I didn't need to capture the entire tower for you to get a feel of what that particular area is about. But using the idea of a long exposure to capture all the different streaks of light. So you have the headlights and the taillights, all kinds of interesting things. And on the hour, all these beautiful twinkly lights come on in the city, which I think is very expressive and interesting. So on the Eiffel Tower, they'll twinkle for maybe 10 minutes or so, and then that's it. So working with the idea of long exposure in that particular image. Everybody know where this is?
Yeah,
right here. It's one of my favorite places. And this compositionally, it was just hard because I'd never been to the Flatiron Building, and I wanted to shoot the entire Flatiron bit, which was good. I have a shot of that, but I felt like this shot gives you more feeling of being in that area. It's a bit more frenzy. Obviously, the yellow taxis speak about New York, so this has become much more expressive. And then again, rather than freeze the action, a little bit longer exposure. This was about 3 seconds. Again, to blur some of the cars there. And the first thing that I get asked about this composition: were you standing in the middle of the intersection? So, no. There's actually a little island. It's like a little V shape. And I use a zoom lens, so I was able to stand relatively safely, depending on how these cars were, and just zoom out a little bit. And you get the sensation that those cars are passing. So you have this sense of motion, and you have a feeling about New York City, and the hint of that's a Flatiron Building. So that's another way to work with that. Of course, stopping down with the Starburst, didn't mind really giving them a little bit more emphasis here, but just because they're going to be in the shot. Sometimes I try not to get all those big bright lights, but if they're going to be there, let them be there for glamour and beauty and a little bit of drama. I was low. Now this is a different thing. If I'm standing here, a lot of people tend to set up their tripods and shoot right at eye level. But if you can get down very, very low and shoot more, it gives you a different sense of power with the composition. So it works very, very well to get low. They make all kinds of neat little short tripods. If you look around here, B&H, I'm sure you'll find some of these little Jobies or things. I bought this one called a Joby Focus that is about this big, and it's nice. It can wrap around wire. You can put it on ledges and put it all kinds of places. So it's easy to get your tripod at the angle that you want. This is probably one of the coolest places on the planet.
Neon Boneyard.
Yes, it is.
It's the
there last week.
Where is it? It's the Neon Boneyard. They call it the Neon Museum. But what it is they take all the beautiful, fabulous signs, and they have put them in one location. And it's amazing. So they are illuminated from, obviously they're older, not functioning signs. They're illuminated from external light sources, which change. This is in Las Vegas. Yeah, I just got back from Las Vegas. We arranged for a private tour for our group because you're not allowed to go in with tripods. And so we were able to go in with tripods and at night. And they have a right next to this facility, have an adjacent room with brand new signs, but they're not lit. So we got to light paint them. Oh my goodness, that was fun. So we had the flashlight and just painting from there. It was beautiful. So this was 16 millimeter fisheye lens. And the idea really changes the dynamics of the composition, because then you have a sense of being in that path. 16 to 35 gives you a little bit different interpretation. But I shot it with a 16 to 35 this year, and I think of it circular fisheye. I use a little circular fisheye, but this was my favorite with just a straight 16. So really, really wide view. So you can also photograph the moon. So after dark, we have actually twilight's the best time to shoot the moon because it's so much balanced. But you can photograph the moon, especially during twilight, for the most balanced type of a composition. Otherwise, you need to sometimes make two different compositions and layer them in. It's a bit more complex because the brightness of the moon is so totally different for the type of composition and exposure that you would need for your landscape. So it's a little bit different. Wide-angle lens makes it a little bit easier to be able to shoot, so that you don't have to worry about the brightness of the moon so much. But here, this is also Marina Island. You saw that one shot a little bit earlier. So the moon was just visible beyond the boats. And so I'm shooting at twilight to be able to use that beautiful light to show off the moon. Was this about a 5-second exposure? No, there are apps to help you determine this. So if you use photographer's ephemeris called TPE, there's a bunch of them on the market, but they will tell you when to expect moonrise in a certain location and tide charts and all kinds of things that can become very interesting. So that'll help you determine where you need to be to be able to capture a more expressive image. So the recipe for this shot, Marina Island. 5 seconds. Again, 5 seconds is pushing it a little bit because those masts could potentially move. But this, with this particular exposure and a very calm day, it worked out just fine. You can use in post. Again, I didn't want to make this about post-processing, but there are a lot of things you can do in post. And we'll talk about conversion to black and white. I like to use MacFun has Tonality Pro and it has Intensify, which is great. I'm also using the Nik color effects filter. So there's like Pro Contrast. There's all kinds of great filters that you use just sort of to accentuate an image. So this is a Vanacuba out my window. Again, I'm using that crazy fun 16 millimeter fisheye lens. Really great expressive type of an image. And with certain images, I find that removing the color allows the scene to become more expressive and more dramatic. Sometimes you have that connotation of color. Red is very, you know, suggests power. Blue is very tranquil. And sometimes if you just take the color away, it's all about the light, the texture, the tonality throughout the image. So this makes a dramatic difference with an image. So sometimes if you're fighting with it, just simply try converting it to black and white. It can make a big difference. 30 seconds. Stopping down for that starburst effect and convert it to black and white. I use Nik Silver quite a bit, but now that Tonality is out from MacFun collection, this is, I don't know if you've heard about this particular software, but it's a brilliant software for conversion. Additional gear. So tripod, cable release, remote release. I use a Phoenix LD22. You know, and if you have any question, you can send me an email. I've got my business cards here. I'll send you a handout so you don't have to write all this down. I don't want you to feel like you have to absorb all this so quickly. I can certainly send you a handout. But this is what I use. I use a little Rogue flash gel so you can hold them over the flashlight and paint a subject as we were doing in New Mexico. Extra camera batteries, gaffer's tape. Oh my goodness, that comes in handy for just about everything. Maybe it's a little breezy and you want to tape down something on your camera. That works really, really well. The lens hood. So here on my Nikon camera, you see I have a lens hood at night. I'm using this as you would during the day. You don't want light falling on the lens. At night, it can cause reflections and little things that you prefer not to be in your composition. So now we're going to switch gears. We talked about low light, shooting just at low light, how to get these beautiful expressive images at the beautiful time of day. So now we'll talk about a tool that you can use to help you during the day. So you're shooting during the day, you've reached the limits of your camera, what tool do you use? And that's a variable neutral density filter. So variable will let you control light between 2 and 8 stops, and that's a big generalization because some people will find that it works a little bit difficult with a wide-angle lens. It works similar to a polarizer because you can rotate, again, between 2 and 8 stops. Use your lowest ISO because if you increase your ISO, then you're fighting against the whole purpose of using a variable neutral density filter. So this will allow you to stop down and create a longer exposure. That's the purpose of this variable neutral. So you've all seen the waterfall pictures where the waterfalls and silky motion. That's the tool that you use to be able to do this. Because often if you shoot and freeze the action, it creates a tense kind of look. My mother likes them tense. I like them soft. So it's a bit much more expressive. So you can do creative effects, blur, water, clouds, all kinds of different things. So what it does is pretty much acts like a pair of sunglasses. You put on a pair of sunglasses, reduces the amount of light that reaches past your eyes, reaches the camera sensor, same idea. Variable neutral density filter. Singray makes one. It's a variable neutral density filter. It's a color enhancing filter and polarizer all built in one. So that's a really interesting one. Tiffin makes one. The design of the Tiffin is such that it's a little bit wider. If your camera is 77, it's actually a little bit wider than that, so it prevents the issue of vignetting, which can be a problem. But this is what it does. If you hold one up, you can see how it reduces the amount of light that reaches the camera sensors, and it gives you more creative control. Everybody knows where this is, right? This is one of my favorite places to shoot here. And the idea of it is that I wanted to create a sense of tranquility with the water and have this a wonderful city light. So this was actually done shot at twilight. Again, if you're shooting at twilight, all the little city lights are still on, and that's what's going to make a difference in a cityscape type of a shot. So with this particular image, F16, 30 seconds. Again, it was just that the 28 to 300 millimeter shooting at twilight. I have the color version. I just like the black and white more. I just thought it was more expressive, and it allowed all the I think the cityscape turns out a little bit more interesting with the black and white. So working with that idea. So you can freeze the action of a fountain, or you can let it be blurred by applying a variable neutral density filter. A variable neutral density filter is making that exposure a little bit longer, so the water is softer. So you have this really nice sense of peace and gracefulness when you look at the image. So shoot it so you freeze the action, shoot it so you slow it down. So it gives you a lot of different ways to work with your subject. And the idea of neutral density filters and any filter in general is that it allows you to become more creative. So it's not that you're just documenting the experience, so you have a snapshot of that experience. It's more expressive and creative. So F16, 20th of a second. Now this exposure, it doesn't take that long. Sometimes it's just a very short, long exposure, so to speak, that'll allow you to do this. So the variable neutral density filter allowed me to create more of an expressive image. Naples. This is not that far from me, about 4 hours south. There's anytime there's remnants of an old dock, I love to work with that idea. And if I'm shooting, I'm certainly not getting the same depth of feeling in this particular photo because the water is frozen and it's more tense. So if I'm using something like a variable neutral density filter, you have the sense of motion and time passing. That's the key element of working with those filters. So I'm working with low light, it's really just sunset, and you have wonderful reflections that are coming through this particular image and all these little birds that are perched there. So again, I was at the limits of my camera. I had already stopped down as far as I dared to go. I'm at the lowest ISO. So I needed a tool that would help me extend the exposure time, and that would be a variable neutral density filter. You may be able to achieve that with a polarizer, so you can try what tool that you have and see how it works for you. But I want to give the viewer a sense of emotion, motion and emotion about a subject. This is just a simple pan blur. But again, when I first started, I couldn't achieve the pan blur because it was too fast. So I just put on the neutral density filter, the variable, and created an impressionistic look of this. You kind of know it's the ocean, you know it's sunset. I don't have to smack you over the head saying, you know, if this is a frozen shot, this is a more expressive, more dynamic shot of this ocean. So here's the recipe for that particular image. I love that it was soft, and this is nice. So when I'm taking pictures, I like to think about building a lot of different ideas. So I try to use all the tools and techniques that I have available to me. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that as far as it may just not, maybe the shot of the image, maybe the long exposure shot, and then maybe I did multiple exposures of that shot, and maybe I did a time lapse of that. And that gives you altogether a great way to build a combination of images to present to the viewer. So you may be presenting to your camera club, maybe you're working on something interesting for your website or a community center. There's a lot of different ideas. But you can convey a sense of motion. And sometimes you really don't even need, it was very low light. I just got back from Iceland, oh my goodness. And it was, I didn't have to worry about neutral density filters because it was already dark. So I was able to work with that. But rather than freeze the action with this crashing water around the iceberg, so I'm working with a relatively short exposure of a quarter of a second, just to be able to convey a sense of motion. So it's about the iceberg, but it's also about the crashing waves that were coming over the iceberg. And you can have it gives a different feeling for this particular image. So I love, it was just as much about the action of the water around than it was just the iceberg. It becomes all together. And that was photographed with the 810. South Beach. Just got back from scouting South Beach for a workshop that we'll be doing next year. I love this area. If you've been to Miami South Beach, it's fabulous. They have these vintage lifeguard stands, and they're all going to be redone by next year. And of course, it has the beautiful Art Deco buildings, and it has the beach, which is amazing to me. I love the beach. I grew up on the beach. This is very near and dear to my heart. So the idea of this was, again, not to freeze the action as much as convey a sense of motion. I want you, when you look at the picture, to feel how it was to be there at that moment, to see the action of the waves and how flirtatious and playful the water is in the foreground, and yet still have this, you know, really interesting clouds and sunset. So it didn't take very long to do this. It was not really a really long exposure. It was just more of a relatively short exposure. Thing I like about this, not to particularly talk about a certain product, but this has a native ISO 64, Nikon A10. Oh my goodness, that's so helpful when you're a long exposure photographer. It has more flexibility and gives you more creative options. So 16 to 35 millimeter lens, and I use that two-stop graduated neutral density filter, again, to hold back light. You can see at the top of the frame was much, much brighter, so that was the tool that I used. So you can use those graduated neutral density filters to help you work in that situation. So it's a relatively short, long exposure, but the idea of any exposure like that is to convey a sense of motion or time passing. Boom, back in New York. Love the taxis. There are so many cool places. You can go down to Times Square and shoot this now. I mean, there's taxis, you're panning. This is about, I think a sixth of a second, but just pan as you are shooting and you can get this really interesting sense of motion with cars. Especially with taxis, you kind of know that it's New York. Back in London, this is so much fun. I love doing this. It was just, as these buses were passing, I wanted to give you a sense that you could just feel the bus passing you. So rather than freeze the action, going ahead and allow this about a 15th of a second as this bus passed by. So you have the iconic Tower Bridge, which you see is a recurring theme in my London shots. I love that place. But this place is full of these red buses, so it's very, very easy. So I set up, and it does, again, look like I'm in the middle of the road. I'm sorry, I'm not. I'm right at the edge. There's actually a bike lane there, but I didn't impede on the bike lane, but just shot as close as I can with the 16 to 35, and as that bus passed, was able to capture the shot. So you can do that here. It's a lot of buses. They make all kinds of great action photos. Stopping down, so I'm stopping down to about F16 or F22 in this photograph. So this is just fun stuff. So it's cold, let's say you're here, it's New York, it's snowing, and you're sitting there, and oh my gosh, wish I was in the beautiful warmth of the sun. You can do that. So the idea of this photo was to convey a sense of motion with the starfish. They had action, like some kind of a feeling of movement about these two starfish. So basically this is a setup, white foam core, bought some beach sand and some little starfish that I bought at the fabric store or Marshall's or whatever it was. So I had these little starfish, and my camera set up on a tripod and it's oriented down towards the starfish. During the exposure, I zoom the lens, and that's all there is to that, just like any other type of panning. So here it gives it a sense of motion, so you can certainly do that. And then I brought these starfish out to the real beach and tried the same thing. Then they got limp, and everybody thought I caught a real starfish, and I explained, no, I didn't do that. No, they're from the store. So we talked about shooting at the edge of night, and we talked about using low light, and we talked about variable neutral density filters. So now we're going to switch gears. We're going to move into the game changer of the 10-stop neutral density filters, and that's the part to me that's very, very exciting. It's a game changer as far as creativity. So what do you have? Oh my goodness, we have Stingray Morslow. That's primarily what I use. Also use the Liebig stopper. Now there's difference in the types of, and I'll show you the difference here. These are the ones I'm using right here. These are just the ring mounts. They're easy to travel with. There's a 10 and there's a 5, so you can stack them. So you can get some really, really creative effects. So that's the Stingray, but you can get them in the ring mount or the flat. There's Liebig stopper, and they make it for the smaller cameras too. Lee sent me out some really fabulous, the 7.5 system, to use with the smaller mirrorless camera, the Nikon 1V1, I think, at the time. B&W makes it. There's a whole bunch of manufacturers. I tend to lean toward Stingray, primarily because of the least amount of color cast that will be introduced into the photo. So, if you have used, well, I wrote a book on infrared, I think I told you, so the idea of using a filter wasn't that foreign, because you had to compose, meter, focus first, then mount the filter on the lens. And that's really the same process that you're seeing here of, again, Tower Bridge, one of my favorite places. So I'm setting up, use a cable release, mount it up, and this one I'm using the flat. You can see I have the Lee Foundation kit, which you can get here, I'm pretty sure, the Lee Foundation kit, and also this, the Big Stopper at the time, I was using Big Stopper for this picture. So I like this picture as far as by itself. I had shot this with the clouds as you see them in this picture. The next way to work with this was to extend the exposure time and smooth out those clouds. So there's all kinds of interesting ways you can maximize your opportunities with the subject. You can see the foundation kit. This is one that I was using, foundation kit. It's a holder and adapter, so you can stack up 2-3 filters if you were so inclined. You could stack a 10 stop, a 4 or 5 stop, and you can also stack a graduating neutral density filter if you needed to. And those are pretty much what they look like. That's the square I showed you, the circular. These are the ring mount neutral density filters. The thing, there's advantages and disadvantages to both. I love the ring mounts for travel. With the wide angle lenses, sometimes the flat mounts work a little bit better. So it's just, you know, as far as whatever's going to work for you. And the graduating neutral density filter, this is a grad, different than a variable, which I showed you earlier. The grad, see how it fades towards the center? That's what the idea of that is. It holds back light and balances the light in your composition. So if you're shooting and the sky is way too blown out and you prefer not to make those HDR pictures, you can use this particular tool. So how do you calculate exposures? This is where it gets very complex. So you mount a 10-stop neutral density filter on your camera, and your base exposure was a 60th of a second. So if you're really good at math and you have a spreadsheet, you can figure all that out at the scene. By then, whatever cloud that you wanted was near gone. So this is what I use. I just use this. There's a whole bunch of them on the market, but they're generally pretty inexpensive. But this will calculate the exposure for you. And the nice thing is, I generally am not using just 10 stops. I'm going to place another 5 stops on there because I want it to be very, very expressive, very, very different. So that means I have to calculate for that extra stops. So this will do it for me. So it has, I can stack a filter and it will tell me what my exposure time needs to be. So it saves time in the field to be able to have that. So if you think about what happens, it's pretty magical. If you're shooting at a 60th of a second, you have one image that represents the action being frozen at a 60th of a second. When you mount a 10 stop and another 5 stops neutral density filter, your exposure time really stretches out into 5-6 minutes or so. And so you can imagine all the difference. You blur clouds, water, people. It's a game changer. It's absolutely very, very expressive. I was in Provence earlier this year. It's one of my favorite places on the planet. It was the most beautiful place. This is where all the lavender comes from. So if you go to Provence, and this is a particular area, it was in the Valençal Plain. It was early one morning, and the clouds that weren't very remarkable, but I had an idea that if I used a 10-stop neutral density filter, it was going to look a lot different. So what happens is, as these clouds begin to evolve during the time that I press the shutter and release the shutter, we have a much more expressive, much more dynamic, and a much more emotional type of image for the viewer. So I'm working with the idea of this. This was 354 seconds at f11 at the Valençal Plain one morning. Car hinge. This is so much fun. The place itself, it's just so random. It's one of those road trip places in the middle of nowhere that you can go to. And it was weird because I wanted to go to the real Stonehenge, but I couldn't make it, so I was able to go to this one instead. And I tell you, I think this was more fun. I think it was a lot more fun. We had fabulous clouds, just fabulous clouds. So I definitely shot this in infrared. I did regular color shots, then stretched the exposure here for 52 seconds using the Moore's Law. 10-stop neutral density filter. So then what it does is softens the clouds, and it allows the cars to become a little bit more dominant. So they're sort of they play a supporting role in this particular picture. So this is a fun place. So when we go to the Badlands, we had stopped and did this little side trip to Carhenge. It was an absolute blast. London, I love this. The London Eye, I think it takes about 30 minutes for it to complete a revolution. And then and if you stand there and you look at it, just like if you look at the high roller in Vegas, I mean, you're not gonna get a sensation that it's actually moving. You're going to get an idea of, you know, how we normally see it. It looks pretty still. But I wanted the viewer to see this in motion, and I wanted the clouds in the background to be soft and more expressive. Plus, it was a lot more fun. So I took the regular shot. I used the neutral density filter to extend the exposure to have, I mean, obviously people wouldn't be able to survive at that velocity, but you get the idea of what it would be like if it was moving. And it did a time lapse here. So I'm using, again, everything that I can think of to work up with the idea. I love this particular area. F16, 113 seconds. And that's just when I release the shutter. Again, the app is telling me, you know, what my base exposure to be, but if it gets darker, I might extend the exposure time a little bit. This was with the Lee Big Stopper and a 4-stop neutral density filter. Again, removing the color to create a more expressive image. So there's a trick, I will tell you. It's not really a trick, it's more like a technique. It's more like a necessity. On the back of your camera, you have a window, little viewfinder window, which can be closed or open. So this is where you really want to make sure that viewfinder window is closed during exposure. So if you're looking at exposures over 20, 30 seconds, it can become another light source and cause a little bit of leak into your picture. So if you ever get a picture like this, which I hate to show you, it's because I forgot to close the viewfinder window. So make sure that is closed. If you're getting all these funky magenta shades and all that, you'll realize, oh yes, I need to close the viewfinder window. And it's painful because you've already invested 4 or 5 minutes into your exposure, and then you look at it and oops, I have to do that one again, kind of thing. So one of my favorite locations in the area on the Space Coast where I grew up, I love the idea of the clouds at sunset. I did this as a time lapse, but I just love the individual images. So long exposure during sunset, which is a challenge because it is brighter, you can use the tools that you have to be able to create a long exposure. So I wanted to give you, you can see the difference in the water. The water's very, very silky, yet the clouds have the sense of motion. So there's a wonderful push-pull tension about that. And let me skip over to this one. Tower Bridge in London, fast moving clouds, neutral density filter. So here's where you really couldn't use a graduated neutral density filter, because why? The graduated neutral density filter would also darken the tower, so I didn't have that option. So, but it was pretty much balanced. I think the newer cameras, the tonality is so great that when you're working with your images in post, you can be able to make adjustments that is more balanced. That's the nice thing. But I wanted to shoot the Tower Bridge. I wanted to give the viewer a sense of motion of the cloud streaking across the sky, and also the silkiness of the water in at Tower Bridge. F16. About 200 seconds, ISO 100, again using that lowest ISO, 24 to 70, using the Lee Big Stopper. I think you can get those here, but you better be quick because they go fast. So you really have to work fast. Another place in London. Again, I'm going to all these iconic places that everybody goes to as a tourist, but I don't want to come back with tourist pictures. I want to come back with something that's more expressive, more personal, and more dramatic. So over 5 minutes, the people disappear. It's amazing what happens. So if you want to vaporize all those people, get rid of them. Except for those two people in the middle. They sat there. They stood there and talked for 5 whole minutes. But it worked, right? I mean, they're just, you know, it's just enough to give some interest into the picture. But it stretched the clouds across the sky. And streaked them so you have a really nice expressive type of an image. This is what it looked like before. So different. I mean, you can see the difference. This is a snapshot. The picture before was more artistic, and that's what I want to come back with as a photographer. Again, as photographers, we're artists, and those are the tools that we have. One of my favorite places, again, in the Melbourne area, is this developing clouds. So always in August, I try to get out and shoot these fabulous clouds that we have. And again, you can see this push-pull tension using a 16 to 35 millimeter lens. Zoom, it just takes you right into that vanishing point. And have all the soft water, it's very, very silky, but then you have all the action of the clouds above. And that's my personal project. I love to work with that idea of that tension between tranquility yet very active cloud formations. About 76 seconds, 16 to 35 millimeter lens. And this triangulation effect is something easily you can achieve with a 16 to 35. You have that disappearing perspective, that vanishing point, which is really pretty cool. So once I shot that way, I'm looking for an alternative shot. So I just simply positioned myself to the side of that and got a different look of that same particular area. It's a f22, 90 seconds of this developing storm. So if you come to Florida in August, I can guarantee, they'll guarantee that you'll get some very, very active storms in the heat. But you saw that that picture earlier that I had of this remnants of an old dock in the Sanford area. I love to work with this. So I had just come back. Sometimes I just want to decompress. I want to be by myself. I want to take my camera and I'll just go and shoot. And that's the idea of this. So you have this action, this sense of motion. But again, really, the water's soft and you get a lot of wonderful reflections. This is 84 seconds at f16, 16 to 35 millimeter lens. Use the Liebig stopper. This is where the Liebig stopper has it can give you a slight blue cast, but I think it really works for a lot of the different images, and certainly you can correct that easily in post. But I love the cloud formations that happen. And so you really have this sense of motion, and that's what definitely working for. I think you saw the car hinge. Yes. I certainly will. We'll talk about that in a little bit. We're going to hold questions toward the end, and so don't forget that. But yes, but white balance, that's a good choice, and that's a good point, because that does alter how, in any photograph, the white balance is going to alter the perception, the mood, the emotion of a photograph. So in these photographs, with the big stopper, I'm using a white balance setting probably of 9,000. Because that it does introduce a bit of a blue cast. With the Stingray, and that's a good question, by the way, I think, but we'll be working with the filters that don't introduce that much of a color cast. It only has a slight warm cast, so. This is the spawning salmon, or I don't know, it's another car hinge thing. It was crazy, but I love the idea again of softening the cloud, stretching this exposure over 57 seconds. To be able to create a really expressive type of a look. Badlands, we were at the Badlands. Klaus went with us here. It's amazing opportunities. I really, it's hard to understand that kind of a landscape until you're there. It's just, the terrain is like some type of Martian terrain. It's just amazing. But what's equally amazing are the cloud formations that usually happen in this particular area. It can be just so very different. Here the clouds are stretching left to right. I have some where they're coming up. It's just, you're building a composition about the clouds and also of this interesting terrain. So it's always a challenge to shoot at the Badlands, but you have fantastic options. This is F16, about 266 seconds. So you find some clouds that move for you and some that don't move as much. So that's when you have to really work with longer. Maybe you'll have to bring an additional 5 stops with your tent. So what we pretty much covered were neutral density, filter, solids, grads, variables, FLW filter, polarizer, white balance does affect the color. So you can do this with your camera. So you can scroll through the different white balance to see the effect it has on your image. So you can use live view. So that's a cool thing. Regardless if you're shooting long exposure, it just gives you a really cool way to get an idea of how to work with a color, what's going to be the most expressive. And I'm not always worried about what the right white balance is. I'm worried about the color that is going to be more expressive and more dramatic and bring out my photographs. So I don't get too hung up on what it's supposed to be rather than what I want it to be. We talked about aperture, stopping down for the starburst effect. Shutter speed for, that's gonna affect absolutely everything. You can extend the shutter speed for beautiful reflections. Shooting at twilight for the balanced sky, again, twilight. If you go to Times Square tonight, oh my goodness. Try to get it at that blue hour, and that's when, because it's so contrasty. All those big signs are very dark, and I'll be very bright compared to a dark sky. So if you have the idea of working with a more balanced light, that twilight will certainly help you. We talked about shooting under the light of the moon and doing a little light painting and panning. So you have a lot of different ideas. So sort of a recap of what we've covered so far. So now we're going to move into shooting for the stars. So this is fun stuff, shooting for the stars. So you've shot in the morning, you've shot during the day with a very neutral density filter, you shot at twilight, you shot at dark, and you can't go to sleep yet because you still you still have to shoot for the stars. So that's really and it's not hard. It's not as hard as you think. I thought that was really overwhelming at first. But here's sort of the recipe. The variable will be ISO. You're generally shooting wide open. It's going to be about 25 to 30 seconds. What's going to vary is the ISO. So it could be 800, it could be 400, it could be 1600. It's really going to depend. Again, if you're shooting in RAW, you have the most flexibility in post-processing. And again, that choice of noise reduction, either at the time of capture or in post-processing, that's your decision on that. Histogram, absolutely. The meter is going to probably, you're going to think that it's exposed correctly, but definitely check the histogram because it's very, very easy to underexpose night shots. And you can use HDR if you want to. That'll just add, maybe you need to enhance the foreground a little bit, so you can use that process of HDR. But I would say trial and error, let the shot evolve. I'd make a test shot, see where you are. Again, this is problem solving. You know, see what works, what doesn't work, what could be improved. So those are the steps. Clouds add a lot of drama. This is South Beach. These are those old vintage areas, these little lifeguard stands. So it looks like it's shot during the day, but it's actually shot at night. You can see the stars. The moon was behind the clouds, so it totally illuminated the scene. And behind me were the city lights, so it's illuminating the backside of this particular South Beach, Miami. 30 seconds, ISO 500, 60 to 35 millimeter lens. Again, those moonlit clouds are going to add all the drama. Stars as pinpoints, you have the opportunity. Again, you want to maximize your opportunity. So I'm shooting stars at pinpoint. So I'm working with moving into falling stars. So it's really pretty cool stuff. This is a 16 to 35 millimeter, or excuse me, this is a 16 millimeter fisheye lens. And that's allowing me to capture most of the scene. I don't mind a little bit of distortion. That's a lot of fun. Stars as comets. How cool is that? So you can do all kinds of things. This is simply a function of how you post-process. So again, you can have the stars look pretty much how you like. But I like that they look like it was raining stars, so you could do that. That's very, very easy. These were 30 seconds, ISO 1600, 16 millimeter lens. I'm using the camera. In Nikon, there is a built-in intervalometer, which is very, very cool. And it also allows you to do all kinds of things. You can do time-lapse shooting. It has an exposure smoothing option, which is very nice. But this one, I'm just using the in-camera intervalometer. I know I had a student on my last workshop in Las Vegas, but he had to rely on an external device for his particular images. So make sure that if you need one, you have one to be able to do that. If you go to the Nikon site, you can read a little bit more about this. This is Photographing the Night Sky. I did a little project with Pete Salutis and Harold Davis, and the Nikon interviewed us. So we have an article. Anybody can read it if you go to the Nikon site. Look for the North Star. So here you need your app to determine where the North Star is, and then you can build your composition around this. So here, I'm offsetting the composition, so because I didn't want the center of stars to be dead center, I wanted to have it off so it has a more dynamic and interesting flow. So there's also an article there about photographing star trails. So if you go to that site, there's actually this one, and Nikon interviewed me for long exposure also. So there is another one up there too. So it's easy reading, and you can be able to find it from there. Rocky Mountain National Park, 30 seconds, f4, ISO 640. So that was the idea behind that particular image. Or you can do this. This is one you can do in Photoshop. So if you have just a picture of stars only in Photoshop, there's an awesome little star rotation action that will allow you to create kind of an expressive image. So this is started out as an infrared image that I took on a trip to Europe, and I built that image and I put the stars behind it and rotated, did all kinds of fun stuff. So you can have a lot of creative options and just fun stuff with your photography. The idea really is to enjoy it, to have fun with it. You know, it's your passion. So it doesn't have to be documentary, photojournalistic. You could be very, very artistic. So star trail photography, pretty much locate north using the app. If you're doing the star trails, this is crucial. So if you have your camera set for in the noise reduction, you don't want to do that for star trails because it's going to take 30 seconds to do that and you won't be able to move on. So you want to make sure you move on to the next shot within the 30 second range. So I'm using Photoshop Extended scripts, but there's another one you can use is called Star Stacks. There's all kinds of different action. There's Star Circle Academy, which has an action to actually blend these for you. So it'll be in the handout, don't worry, I'll send it to you. So tripod and lens selection, absolutely. I'm using a wide angle lens. If I'm shooting stars, definitely using the wide angle lens. 25 to 30 seconds, and definitely a sturdy tripod. That's gonna make a big difference in your stars. So you have to, if it sags during your exposures, it's gonna mess up your shot. So we'll talk real quick about black and white conversion. Santiago de Cuba, that's a beautiful place. The idea behind this shot was I wanted to, it already look, again, I like to let the subject guide me on how I should process the image. And the idea behind this was I wanted it to look vintage. I wanted it to look more like it as an old Cuba. So the idea here was just to take away the color, remove the color, and allow the subject to stand out more clearly. F11, varied shutter speeds because I made it as a process of HDR. It was a little bit contrasty with that sky, so I worked with the idea of that 16 to 35 millimeter lens, and then I converted it to black and white. But again, this allows the texture, the tonality, the light, the shadow all to stand out much, much more expressive. 284 second exposure converted to black and white. So now it allows the streaks, the clouds to show up really well in this particular image of Carhenge. So you go to Carhenge, it's always different. 284 seconds. And we'll go back to Badlands. So removing the color in the Badlands. You have this volcano sort of motion of all the clouds coming up from this particular area. And that's really kind of where it's at when you're in an area like the Badlands or any other place. You want to kind of do a quick test shot or pay attention to what direction the clouds are moving because you want to maybe vary your composition. I think it's more dynamic when they're moving up past you rather than side to side. So working with that idea, this is in Badlands, F16, 351 seconds, 16 to 35 millimeter lens. More slow, just the 10 stop, the more slow, and then converting it to black and white. So you could do this. So you could go, let's say you had a park in your particular area, you wanted to work with the idea of stretching out those clouds. In my area, it would be Lake Eola, and I can experiment with the idea of how the clouds are going to work. So creative post-processing. So minimal post-processing. The Mac Fun Tonality, if you're a Mac person, there's Nick Collection by Google. Topaz has some different filters on one, if you're here at Photo Plus, all those people I'm sure will be here so you can connect with them and see how the products work. You saw the one picture with the stars. That idea was to work with creating a little starburst effect. That was star effects. And that's kind of nice. You can do it one star, you can use a lot of different stars. So maybe you just want to add a little sparkle in a certain type of photograph. And there's certainly alien skin. So this is Paris. It's from a tower that you can be able to photograph during night. It's so nice. There's nothing obscuring your view. There's no acrylic. I know that in some areas, like, it's hard to shoot through those acrylic barriers. So this, we have an unobstructed view. So this one, I love the night, being able to shoot with this. This is at 5.6, 5 seconds, and then just added just a touch of sparkle, just a touch. But another idea of working with long exposure is, again, my idea of it is that you can work with a variety of ideas. You saw the one picture where I stacked the images, so you can work with that. The idea is time passing, so I want to incorporate a little bit of time lapse video and cinemagraphs, which are absolutely amazing. You work with the idea of cinemagraphs. And if you go to Photo Plus, they do have Flixels there, and that's a really cool kind of place. I used to do them in Photoshop, so and it was so hard because it's based on a video, so it's hard. It starts at a video, but then you're revealing just a little bit of motion. So the birds on top of the statue are still, but we have the pair of birds at the bottom that are playing in the water. Everything else is stationary, but you have this water. So it's absolutely amazing what you can do. So I encourage you, as you're shooting, you know, definitely true variable, 10 stop, but do a little video, do a little time lapse. It's gonna build your whole repertoire of photos to be much more interesting and well-rounded. So this little fountain was in Paris, and I was shooting, and I wanted to give the viewer a sensation of and they loop, they'll continually loop, which is kind of fun. So you can put them on your website, you can include them in an email, you can do all kinds of interesting things. So time-lapse can be a simple story. And now the challenge, again, I'm looking at things critically, what works, doesn't work, what is it about this that could be improved? And I love the clouds, and certainly shot that as a still, and I did shoot it as a long exposure, but I wanted to give you the sensation of being there. But if I shot it as a video, the clouds were moving too slow. I mean, you guys would be asleep by now. It would be boring. But if I use time lapse, so I'm setting up my intervalometer for every 2 seconds, then you get this real sense of, you're appreciating what happens over time. Again, sense of time passing, conveying a sense of motion. So you can do that with time lapse, which I love. So you need really a much more longer than you think. This is probably a 15-second video clips, but that means that you're going to have to invest about 30 minutes in shooting. And if you really want something really long, you may have to shoot a little bit longer. But I like the idea of building in a few different ideas. So you saw Valensole. So this is just a little bit different way to do that. Tower Bridge again. So I'm still back there. But how cool is that? I just things on cue. This comes by. So, you know, it's good to be situationally aware, see what's happening, and I noticed that they were stopping. The bus was stopped, so it had to be stopped for a cool reason. But it's hard to go to London and really get. Usually, if you've been to London, you know that it's very overcast, and you can always get these dramatic clouds. So this is set as a loop. And animation, so this little guy can go back through and through. But this is a story. The drawbridge raises, that's the event. The ship passes, and then you have the drawbridge was like closes. So when you're thinking about video, think about it as a storyboard, having an interesting occurrence, an event, and an end to your story. And I promise I'll get to all your questions in a moment. So we're back at this particular area that I absolutely love. The developing clouds were amazing to me, and I wanted to give the viewer a sense of being there, of what happened. So using a reverse graduated neutral density filter to hold back the light in the sky, and the side effect of that filter is that it gives the clouds a bit more ominous look, just a little bit more, so it makes it a little bit more spooky and a little bit more dramatic. But I love what happens. You've got this interesting sense of motion of these clouds developing, and very, very easy to do a short video clip. So back to London, a shot at, you saw all the different shots. Here's Big Ben again. I love the idea of it. As these clouds were passing, and I was also watching, I knew that the lights on the bridge were coming on. So we have that coming on and off in the photograph. I think that's the one that I do. So boom, I'm in Chicago. This is the obligatory big bean shot. If you go to Chicago, you have to see this. The bean, I assure you, is fabulous at the blue hour. It's absolutely amazing. Shot that in the morning, and because there's hardly any people there, so it naturally worked out really, really well. But I would love to have you on a tour in 2015. We do Chicago, Washington, South Beach, Badlands, a whole different places. So do the fun shots. Do the serious shots that you're all ambitious for, but also do the crazy fun shot. This is my friend and partner, Jason O'Dell, who does the workshops with me, took this photo of me. So this is where we're going to be. It's all on my website. No worries. I'm going to Croatia and Slovenia. Connie came with me.
Carol
came with me last year, and we had a great time. I want to thank you so much for sharing this time with me. You guys are awesome.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.